Last time I did sort of a historical overview. I also wanted to give you a big picture of dynamics or the nonlinear dynamics and chaos. Nonlinear dynamics. I guess half of what I'm going to write is like just linear dynamics. We'll plot along this axis the number of variables going from one variable. So, you know, n equals one, n equals two, n equals three, and greater than equal to three. Kind of, no, greater than equal to four, I guess. We'll do greater than three. And then much, much greater, and then infinite. And then along this axis, nonlinearity, where up here we'll put linear, and down here, nonlinear. So we could start populating, you know, what this is. For n equals one, we're talking about things that just have one variable. So an example would be like exponential growth of a population, like bacteria in a petri dish growing, or like an RC circuit. You could do modeling of, I don't know, charge or current or something. Radioactive decay, right? That's just, so that's, these things are all described by ordinary differential equations that are, they're linear. The equations appear linear. What's linear in n equals two? I guess this would be more like if you've taken mechanics courses, a mass and spring system. So that becomes, that's a linear oscillator. So there it is in the name, simple harmonic motion. N equals three, we've got three variables. You could have a bunch of coupled exponential growth things, or n going to infinity is something that people have looked at quite a bit. I mean, continuum mechanics. So this would be like waves and patterns and linear things like linear elasticity, the wave equation, right? It's a linear PDE, and you might think, well, why am I incorporating PDEs here? I'm thinking of a PDE is sort of equivalent to infinite dimensional ODE. There's a electromagnetism, so Maxwell's equations are actually linear PDEs. Even quantum mechanics is linear. So like the Schrodinger. It's fun to write Schrodinger because you put those two little dots over the O. Heat and diffusivity, other things related to continuum. N much greater than one, we've got coupled simple harmonic oscillators. Imagine a bunch of springs and stuff and masses. But this is the kind of thing that you learn, especially engineers. You sort of do this in like the early physics courses. You do this linear stuff in one and two dimensions. And then often it just sort of jumps to up here, PDEs and waves. Still linear though, because we have techniques for studying linear systems. So we're very comfortable with that. In fact, if we have something that's nonlinear, we linearize it and then study it often. So what about down here? What is an example of something that's one-dimensional and nonlinear? As we'll talk about today, I think we'll get to it, like population growth. That's the thing that was the logistic equation. A skydiver, if you were to jump out of an airplane and we're looking at your velocity as a function of time, so that's the one variable. You've got gravity, but then drag is quadratic in the velocity. So the dynamics of a skydiver, at least in the vertical direction in terms of what their velocity is, it's going to be non-linear. Maybe we could think of other things. I don't know. N equals two variables that describe something, and it's non-linear. The pendulum near the bottom of its swing moves like a simple harmonic oscillator, but definitely as you get to larger amplitudes, in fact, the ability to kind of go all the way around it's part of the nonlinear behavior of a pendulum. You might say, why is that n equals two? I thought we're just looking at the angle, but right now we have to look at the angle and the angular velocity. So that's where the two comes from. Nonlinear oscillators, predator prey cycles are kind of fall into here. We'll probably talk about those. The two variables here would be number of prey versus number of predators. And depending on how hungry predators are and how many prey there are left, you can get cycles going. Biological oscillators, like heart cells, biological oscillators. So neurons, heart cells. Once we get to n equals three, so I guess here's a key thing. In terms of differential equations, if you have just n equals one, you can't have oscillations. You just have kind of growth and equilibria. You can have oscillations when you get to n equals two. You can't have chaos for topological reasons that we'll talk about later. You can't have chaos until you get to n equals three. So n equals three, nonlinear, this is where you could get chaos, like the Lorenz system has three variables. And even though sometimes they're not necessarily related to dynamics, I would say I would group fractals with this, you know, n equals three. There's some weird things about fractals, like you can talk about dimensions that aren't whole numbers. Like supposedly a crumpled piece of paper has a dimension between two and three. We'll talk about that. The coastline of Britain, it's not one dimensional, it's somewhere between one and two. I'm skeptical of those things, but I will discuss them. All right, n greater than three. Well, now we get to interesting stuff like the three-body problem that Poincaré and I worked on. And that for that one, the minimum is n equals four variables to get that. So the three-body problem. I'm not necessarily going to group myself with Poincaré. He was one of my heroes, though, when I was grad school. As we go to larger and larger numbers, what about I mentioned coupled simple harmonic oscillators under this kind of n equals, n is much, much greater than one. Well, we could have coupled nonlinear oscillators. Nonlinear solid state physics is in here. So things related to electronics. Down here in the lower right, if something has infinite variables and it's nonlinear, this would be spatio-temporal chaos. Instead of like the linear wave equation, there are nonlinear waves. So where like shock waves and solitons, think of, you know, tsunamis, earthquakes, turbulence, and the Navier-Stokes equation. So the Navier-Stokes equation is famously, that's the PDE that describes fluids, and it is notoriously nonlinear. What else? General relativity is in here. So it's kind of weird. Like quantum mechanics is up here as infinite but linear, and general relativity is infinite and nonlinear. I guess we could just say life itself. Right. If we ever come up with the rules for life. So the frontier is kind of, maybe I'll draw the frontier of where people are doing interesting work is kind of this orange region denoted by the orange. This would be the frontier of work in this area. And like I said, usually in terms of education, you'll just be stuck up here with n equals one and two, linear, and then go across to infinite, but linear. So often you don't get this other stuff down here. So where this class will go is we'll kind of progress with this. We'll be looking at this nonlinear stuff going this way, maybe get to, you know, here. So that's the role of this class. In fact, some of this stuff in the frontier would be, we'd call it collective phenomena. Like it's not infinite, but n is much greater than one. So like spread of diseases, epidemiology, how we all interact as individual agents and spread a disease, or things like dynamics of Twitter, social media, stuff like that falls under this collective phenomena. All of this stuff on nonlinear dynamics and chaos has now been subsumed under a larger heading, which maybe you've heard, and maybe it's not clear where that fits in. Complex systems, which is a bit ambiguous. If you come from a math background, you think, okay, complex, that just means a complex plane, like A plus IB. But, and it's pretty amorphous when someone says complex systems, what they mean. Complex systems could be, I guess in some sense, the most mature part of it would be what we're talking about here, which is nonlinear dynamics and chaos. But there's other aspects to this, like agent-based modeling. There's been a lot of interest in things like networks. Data science, data-driven modeling could also fall under, you know, complex systems. So in some sense, up for complex systems, what you're gonna learn here is the most mature and oldest and most classical of that. And then you could go on and pursue other things. And in terms of the history, right, there was a high point in the 1970s where there was lots of interest in work, kind of the region that this class is covering. And then things settled down and we're just doing kind of practical uses of chaos here and there. So in some sense, what I did for my PhD would fall in here, a practical use of chaos. So chaos in terms of the orbital dynamics I looked at were chaotic, but we were trying to make practical use of it. So use chaos to do something useful efficiently.
What are like the signs of a chaotic system? Maybe I'm getting ahead of myself, but like if you look at a system that's nonlinear, how do you determine it's going to be chaotic without just studying the behavior and then determining it after? Like, can you look at the system and then say, because of these reasons, that this is going to be a chaotic behavior or chaotic system?
I mean, that's a really good question. Usually it's done after the fact based on the behavior, but it sounds like you're asking, could I look at a differential equation and know ahead of time, this is going to have chaotic solutions?
Yeah.
I don't have an answer off the top of my head. That's a good question. Often people will look at solutions, and so we will talk about this. They'll take two initial conditions and measure how quickly do they diverge. And that's called the Lyapunov exponent. And they'll say, oh, if a system has a positive Lyapunov exponent, it's chaotic. So there's, I don't know, hundreds, perhaps thousands of papers from the 80s, 90s, and I don't know what we're calling them, the early 2000s, where all they were doing was showing that chaos existed in something using this method. And it's kind of mind-numbing, and I find it kind of boring, because it's just one paper after another, like, we have shown the existence of chaos in blah, 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 by looking at trajectories. And then they would stop there. It's not like, what does it mean, or what can we do with it? It's just like, well, there's chaos. That's a really good question, and maybe we'll find out at some point. But as far as I know, you can't, if it's nonlinear, it's pretty likely. But you could have nonlinear systems that actually do not have chaos. And that's kind of curious. Wow. And there is a sense, I don't know if we will get to it, because it's kind of involved. It would fall more in this n equals three, a driven oscillators. So think of a spring mass system or even a pendulum where I sort of drive the mass. If I drive this at just the right range of frequencies, I can get chaotic behavior of this pendulum. There is a well-defined sense in which you can describe chaos. And I think we'll get to that, but mostly it'll just be kind of intuition that it seems random, but it's deterministic behind the scenes. So that's a big picture. Be very skeptical whenever anyone says they work on complex systems, because you have to just go further and say, what do you mean by that?